Township Committee meeting to order.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided pursuant to the New Jersey Open Public Meetings Law by posting a notice of this meeting on the bulletin board in the municipal building and by sending a copy of the notice along with the agenda of this meeting to the Atlantic City Press, Atlantic County Record, Record Journal, and current newspapers, stating this meeting would take place at 6:30 p.m. Monday, December 19th, 2016, at the Municipal Building, Mays Landing, New Jersey. Mr. Gishard.
Present.
Mr. Kurtz.
Present.
Mr. Laws.
Present.
Mr. Shanker.
Here.
Mayor Silva.
Present.
Can we take a moment of silence for private reflection? First item on the agenda is guest presentations. First is the annual report from the Senior Citizens Advisory Committee. Good evening.
Good evening, Diane Fox, Senior Citizen Advisory Committee. First, we'd like to thank the committee for your support.
Could you step up a little to the mic?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's actually, we can't hear.
Can't hear it?
Tilt it up, see if it's in.
Can you hear me now?
Faintly.
Right into it, yeah.
Now?
That's better.
If you could just say your name again, I'm sorry.
Yes, Diane Fox, Senior Citizen Advisory Committee. First, we'd like to thank the committee for your support. John, whatever we've needed and we've contacted you, you've got it to us immediately. Rodney, your support in our meetings have been truly remarkable. And Art, whenever we call you and ask you for anything, you've always delivered immediately. We thank you.
My pleasure.
And our committee is Bill Schmidt, Pat Johnson, Pam Scott, Vi Corbo, Diane Welke, and Ruth Zahn. So this year, I'm going to start with the health fairs and the events that we had. So April, we had a health fair at the Mays Landing Library. We had 70 residents attend the event, and we had 4 vendors attend that event, and we had 2 speakers. The turnout was remarkable. In November, we had a health fair at Mitzvah. We had 12 vendors, 20 residents, and 4 speakers. That event went over very well as also. Mitzvah had contacted us and asked us to hold a health fair at their Lundy place, and that's why we went out there. We've attended festivals, Hometown Celebration, Fall Festival, Dickens of Holiday. And this year with the Dickens of Holiday, we had our first annual food drive, which just ended Saturday. That went well, and we've delivered the food to the area pantries. We had meet and greets in October. We did a chili sundae at Tavistock. We had 60 seniors RSVP, and out of the 60, 20 showed. But out of that event, we did we gave them a questionnaire and ask them the things that they need or they would like to see from our committee, what their needs would be. And out of the survey came, and it seems to be the number one thing when the seniors speak to us, is transportation. Sometimes it's they need more transportation, sometimes it's the transportation doesn't work well for us, so that's something that we would like to look into in 2017. Whether we can do that or not, or whether we need to reach out to either the committee or maybe even Atlantic County, that's what we're going to figure out. We had a senior luncheon at St. Vincent de Paul. And the one thing that came out of that luncheon was the seniors were coming and asking us, do we know of anyone that could come and help them do work in their home? So they needed, their home needed to be handicapped now. So that information was given out to them. And I gave them our business card and I asked them to contact us because we wanted to know whether that program is actually working. And our members have also attended several meetings this year in the Mays Landing Library. We went to the Atlantic County Transportation Meeting. We attended the LEAP program for the visually impaired at the library. We've attended area health fairs. And by attending those health fairs, we've made contacts with speakers and other vendors who are now contacting us and asking us to add them to our list for our health fairs and speaker series. We're developing a website for the seniors. And the other few concerns that we've heard from seniors are they want more senior living complexes, not assisted living, not 55 and older, but the 55 and older seniors, where are they at 75, 76, 78? Where are they gonna live? And they bring up, Egg Harbor City has a apartment complex for seniors, and they're bringing that up as an issue of where they're gonna live. And our agenda for 2017 is we're gonna start a speaker series. We're gonna, the PAL building we know is offered to us now, so we're gonna use that as a speaker series. We'd like to do it monthly, whether or not we do that maybe every other month. We're gonna have two more health fairs, and we're also looking into grant money for seniors. So it was a busy year, and I think we've accomplished a lot.
Diane, I think your presence has been felt in the community. You know, most of us on committee have attended many of your events, and I think your interaction has been outstanding. And I can't think of anything else that you should be doing that you would take on because you're busy now. So I congratulate all of you. It's been a most successful year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Diane, I comment on the same thing. Thank you for everything. As the mayor said, we have all attended different events, and even the last one up in Mizpah was very good. I'm hoping that it was so good that I'm hoping we can work on maybe some better attendance. And Fred Nebel, I spoke to him. He's from the Merchants Association. He's willing to help in that area, whether it be the website or Facebook or whatever we can do to get the information out, more flyers, because the program was just great. And we're really looking forward to the coming year. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, some of the things I learned is if we have a health fair during the week and Betty Brackrack attends, they'll provide bus service. So that will help the attendance.
Sure.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah,
I just like to echo some of those same comments. And I think you know in the Mizpah, case of Mizpah, we were competing on that event with two big funerals. So that's the reason for the lower attendance. And I think the one you mentioned where 60 RSVP'd and 20 showed up, wasn't there a weather issue associated with that? Or am I getting that mixed up with another? There may have been.
We did have a speaker there. But I think the issue that day was that it was a beautiful day and the Eagles were playing.
All right. Maybe that's what it was. And I just want to thank the members, all the members of the committee. It's just been a fantastic committee. They've worked tremendously together. They've come up with all kinds of great ideas. And it's really much appreciated. I think you really added to the quality of life for seniors in the community, and it's much appreciated. By the way, I will bring up the transportation issues to the Civic Advisory Committee. On the South Jersey SJTPO. That is one of the issues that will be brought up. So again, thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is the ACUA budget meeting presentation. And I know you'll be brief. Is it gonna cost us any money this year?
It's all free.
Oh, okay. Then you could take a few. Please, you can take a few extra moments then.
Here for our annual budget and rate presentation on the ACUA's relationship. Linda Bazemore, ACUA's Vice President of Administration and Finance, and Hamilton Township resident. This is her first year on the trip around the county, so she's critiquing how well I do this or not so well. So there is no tip fee increase on municipal solid waste. If you look at the middle of the chart, it says special rate. The special rate is for municipal governments, including Hamilton Township, $62.20. This, in 2017, will be the third year that the tipping fee for regular household trash will remain the same. The ACOA gate rate will remain the same. That's for commercial and private customers. That's approximately $5 a ton more. It's projected that your tonnage, you can see in the top chart, will be around $600,000, just over $600,000, based on the projected amount of tons of waste, of household waste, that you'll bring to the ACOA through your contract with Waste Management. The other waste is probably material that the Public Works Department has brought to us by other loads. So those, that's increased this year. You may have had some sort of special cleanup or a couple of events that might have contributed to that. The only tip fee that is going to increase this year is tires. And tires, we don't dispose of them at the ACOA. We have to actually pay for them to be disposed somewhere else. So they're going up. And that cost is going up significantly. So if you have any tires around Public Works yard or somewhere else, I'd encourage you to bring them before the end of the year for disposal. And as you can see, recycling tonnage collected by the ACOA on behalf of the township has gone down slightly, and your yard waste was down a couple hundred tons. That's probably due that it was a very dry year, and so less grass clippings and other yard waste material went out. As a result of that, your recycling rate, this is the recycling rate on the waste generated by the municipality and disposed of and recycled by the municipality, is at 30%, down a little bit. But I think you're doing a pretty good job. We have a good relationship with the Township Public Works.
How does that compare countywide?
I would say that's, given the fact that you're a large rural township, that's pretty good, and a suburban town. So against Galloway and Egg Harbor Township, you're performing well. The towns with the highest recycling rates are Linwood and Northfield. They have a lot of yard waste that they collect. That is, now you have other recycling that goes in town through the commercial sector that you get credit for through your tonnage grant program, and your recycling coordinator gathers that information up. So there's more recycling going on than reported here. So I think you're doing pretty well. But if you would like some help, assistance with the schools, we do work with Greater Egg and Oakcrest. And we have had a number of programs at the Hamilton Township Schools in the last year. We'll continue that work. Okay?
Anybody from committee have any comments, questions?
I just have a question. Will you be continuing in your current position?
I will be continuing in my current position unless okay, something I missed that I'm not aware of.
That's great. Right?
No, that's good. I certainly appreciate it. I was asking that because for some reason I thought there was a mention of retirement and it might have been someone else.
People keep coming up to me and asking me.
I didn't start it. I just wanted to tell you that, you know, we really appreciate your work, and it's gone beyond just your duties. You've helped with the green team. You've been at I don't know how many events after hours, and you've been a real supporter of sustainability, and it's appreciated.
Thank you, Rodney. Appreciate that. Everybody have a wonderful, a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Thank you. You too, Rick.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much. Now, the next item on the agenda is the resolution recommending the appointment of a municipal court judge for the Township of Hamilton Regional Municipal Court.
Mayor, I have a comment on the resolution, if I could.
Yes, sir.
As a member of the Personnel Committee, along with Mayor Silva, Mike Jacobs, Mary Kelly from HR, and after careful consideration of the information provided to all committee members on the nine applicants, plus input from committee members who chose to have an applicant interviewed, I move the name of Michelle Verno for municipal court judge.
Second. A motion and a second. Are there any questions or comments?
Yes, I have a comment. I think it has been our, at least I believe it has been our policy to, when for the key positions in the township, to have the interviews by the committee as a whole. In this particular case, Mr. Kurtz mentioned that everyone had an opportunity. I did not even know the applications were in. I found out they were in my mailbox. Nobody mentioned it. And on the same day I found that out, the interviews were conducted. And I know at least in one case, the individual was called up and asked if he could be available in 2 hours. Now, we did have a meeting on this. We had an executive session meeting. We all recognize the importance of filling this position. But certainly no time during that meeting did I expect that we would have two elected officials making that selection without even having the opportunity to have an input on that, at least have an input on the people who were interviewed. I don't believe this is the way this should be conducted, and I don't see any reason why this has to be done now. We still have a sitting judge. We still have his session is still in. He doesn't retire until the end of the year. So there is no reason to rush to fill this now. By doing so, you're not allowing the input of our newly elected official who is elected for a three-year term. And I think that is not the way to do this. And I don't know whether there have been any precedences like that, where you have an incoming person and the committee then chooses to vote someone in without discussing it as a whole and before it's needed, while the judge is still sitting in his position. I don't think that's right.
You made the same comments the last meeting.
Okay.
You got adequate coverage in the current. I think your comments are duly noted. However, what you don't realize, we've been at this all year trying to deal with this municipal court. We've had meetings with the court administrator of the Superior Court. There's been a lot at work. We're obligated to have this person sitting as judge on January 1. Okay? You're not going to have your newly elected committee person sworn in for the 3rd. Secondly, there's nothing irregular about this. When we selected a chief here, we did it with the personnel committee. It's the same procedure. You've had the book there. The fact, do you come into town hall any day during the week, or do you have to be called?
I come in from time to time.
Okay, you would have found it in your bin. The information.
I don't come in every day and check in my bin, and I would expect when there's something important in my bin that I would get a call to indicate that. And I'm a little disappointed that neither you nor the administrator advised me of that. That's unfortunate. And let me point out, we can have a judge by January 2nd and make the selection on the reorganization day. This is typically a reorganization. This is typically a reorganization appointment. There's no reason that
on January 1. Well, let's not even argue about it at this point. You've made your point, okay? We're moving on with this. Anybody else on committee?
Well, can I ask a question of counsel? Of course, I don't know whether you've had an opportunity to consider this. But are there any legal precedents for this kind of move where we have a sitting judge, an appointment is being made while we have a sitting judge, and that appointment is being made in spite of the fact that we're going to have a newly elected official at the next meeting? It seems to me it's an attempt to get the person wanted before we can have an additional vote here, and that concerns me. So, yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
My understanding is it's necessary to have the position filled before there's actually a vacancy, so that there is no point in time where the township goes without having a sitting municipal court judge. We haven't analyzed it in the context of the change in administration or the change in committee membership. It shouldn't make a substantive difference. It just happens to be that this is a year where there's a changeover at the same time as the position needs to be filled.
So the fact that the the position is filled until December 31st, and that we can't have a reappointment by, what is it, January 2nd? That doesn't have any meaning.
It's an issue we can look at again if you'd like us to. That's fine. There will be a day where there is no municipal court judge, and that makes a difference in terms of service of warrants, for example, where you need to have a municipal court judge sitting.
There'll be 2 days. We don't meet for reorg till the 3rd.
January 2nd is a Sunday, I think.
That's right.
So Sunday, it will Monday. Be several days where there
Our
will
reorg
be...
reorg is on Tuesday.
Right, there will be the need for a judicial function during that period of time, as short as it may be, that may make a meaningful difference in the operation of, for example, police operations in the township.
Well, I thank you for that, but I do know that when we've had situations like that, there is a process whereby we can get a temporary judge if needed. I don't think there'll be any requirement to have a judge for those 2 days, but I hear what you're saying.
Rita, anybody else on committee?
Nope.
Rita, roll call, please.
Mr. Gishard?
I guess I'll have to say no.
Hertz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
Motion's carried 4-1.
Thank you.
And I don't have anything against the person. It's just a procedural reason.
You also had an opportunity, if you wanted anybody interviewed, to bring it up. You had plenty of opportunity. Next item on the agenda is the addition or deletion of late agenda items to be considered for action tonight. And that includes just in addition to the ones that you have on your sheet from consent agenda B and F to be removed.
So moved.
Second.
The motion is second. Any questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Motion carried. Early public comment.
Yes, Mayor. There's Judy Link, and the item addressed is appointment of judge.
My name is Judy Link. I'm the committee woman elect for next year. And I was very taken back by this appointment of the judge. I've done a lot of work or a lot of research on how this transpired. I understand you put the announcement out in the newspaper on the 21st of November, was it? And you expected a response by the 27th. Very, very short. I talked to a number of people who would have liked to submit their name, but it was too late. The other thing is, this is a position that will occur for 3 years. And looking at my package, I have no information about your 9 people that you interviewed, nor do I have anything concerning their qualifications. I think this is very inapropos. And I know for a fact that a judge can be appointed the first of the year if we do not have a judge elected or selected. I'm really quite disappointed, and it just seems to me as though we're starting out on not such a great foot this year. I hope things continue to get better. I hope that the people who were eliminated from this position or whatever, or just not, they couldn't apply, do not follow with a legal ramification, because I feel as though they will. Thank you.
Anybody else, Mike?
Yes, Jim Link, appointment of judge.
Good evening, Jim Link, Park Road. I don't take up too much of your time because Judy said a lot of what I was going to say too. But in 2007, campaign, the mantra of open and honest government was the big thing that year. Well, members of committee who ran in 2007 seem to have forgotten all about open and honest. What you've done seems to be ramming someone through that you guys like to the with no matter, with no care about what anyone else thinks. Well, you've done it. You didn't put the person's name on agenda as an agenda item, okay, which is kind of strange, whereas you do have appointments in personnel. I thought perhaps you might want to put that in there so that we, the public, okay, can make comment on an agenda item before action was taken. This is all contrived, okay? From a parliamentary point of view, perhaps not the most succinct, okay? But certainly, from a public point of view, it's an action that I think is objectionable, okay? Doesn't lend itself to open and honest government. And frankly, you should be ashamed of yourselves stepping off on the wrong foot in 2017 with a newly elected township committee person. It smacks of total, unadulterated partisan politics. In fact, the Senate Majority Leader didn't do what you guys do when a name of a Supreme Court justice was put up in the constitutional manner. So I think you just think about that. I'm sorry it started off this way. I hope things only get better in 2017. Thank you.
Anyone else, Mike?
Bob Campbell.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Campbell, 48 Lewis Drive, Mays Landing, New Jersey. I sat in your seats for 9 years of my life up there, and I know when the decisions were made and how they were made. Certainly, we have a political system here in the community, and we do have two parties, and we have both parties represented up there. I think that you have the privilege of doing whatever you want. I think it would have been a good thing and perfectly legal and proper, according to every legal opinion that I have received, and I've received a number of opinions about the appointment of a judge in Hart Township, or not the appointment, but the recommendation for this judge to be sent to the governor of the state of New Jersey. I do know that if there had been a minor delay, that the assignment judge of the County of Atlantic would assign a judge to take care of any problem that there would be immediately. Am I correct, Mr. Solicitor?
I can't say for sure how quickly he would do it or not. I assume if there was a vacancy, someone at some point would fill it, yes.
Well, it's my understanding that the assignment judge, if there was a vacancy for any reason, the assignment judge would immediately assign someone to take care of any immediate problems. I think it's wholly irresponsible that you couldn't wait a week so that Judy could be sworn in, and she's going to be up there for 3 years, just as you are, Mr. Mayor, and that three-year term that you're going to give to the judge, she should have had an opportunity to review the qualifications of the judge, to vote on it properly, and then let it be what be, or what will happen. If it was 3-2, or if it was 4-1, whatever the vote is, that would have been it. The judge would have been appointed, and that would have been it. But Judy would have had an opportunity. I think you owed it to the people, the community, who elected both yourself and Mrs. Link. You're there, so you don't have to worry. Your voice is heard right straight through. But Judy deserved the right to be involved in this decision. And for what you've done, I think you have done a little irresponsibly, although I do know that you have certain statutory requirements that you have to do. Whether or not they are totally legal, there might be a suggestion of the judge in Atlantic County to review this decision very quickly, and to determine whether this has been done judiciously, properly. It's just a shame that, the thousands of people that voted for you and for Judy don't get the opportunity to let her make a decision on this judge for three full years. I know you have your duty to do, and I know it's important to do your duty, but at the same time, I think out of the common courtesy, and I think in the judicial aspect of our community, to allow Mrs. Link to be able to be part of that situation would have been very, very good. With that, I also would like to change the subject a little bit, and I would just like to say that most of you don't know that Rick Dovey, who was just here, I'm just going to pivot a little bit. Rick Dovey, who was just here, is also the head of the Stockton Foundation. That's the student foundation at Stockton, and that man does for free an enormously wonderful job. So I congratulate Rick Dovey. I know he had to leave, but I wished I would have been able to say that to him personally. And my veterans organization has donated, at this point, thousands of dollars to the foundation. And we're going to continue to do so, educating the young men and women of our community. And finally, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year and a Happy Hanukkah to everyone. Thank you.
Same to you. Okay.
Anyone else, Michael? Okay, moving along.
Roger, can I just make a comment?
Please.
I was not privy to who they had chosen. This was done by the personnel committee. But just sitting here and realizing that Michelle Verno is our prosecutor. You do know that, right? So now she has to be replaced. So given the time frame that we have, choosing the judge now, if it was going to be her, we now have to go into a process of looking for a new prosecutor. So all this takes time, and I think that I feel as though if this was the choice and knowing the problems it would cause not having a prosecutor, this was the right way to handle it.
Thank you. Okay. Next item, discussions. Formal action may be taken. Application from Verizon Wireless for authorization to locate and operate a small network nodes in the public attaching to existing and new utility poles. Mike?
Yes, sir, Mayor. We received this request from Verizon, and it's been reviewed by our solicitor. There's a memo in your packet with his legal opinion, and it's to place these small cans. And everyone has, I think, a picture on top of utility poles existing and maybe some new ones. The request is for an approval throughout the township. And they would then go to the construction office for a permit for each individual site.
Might I ask what those nodes are going to do?
Is it okay if gentlemen?
Come on up, sir.
Hi, good evening. I'm Phil Flanagan with Tilson Technology, and Tilson is representing Verizon Wireless on this project throughout the state of New Jersey. So the small network nodes are designed to augment existing cell towers. They're basically hardwired or wired by fiber optic cable from the location on top of a utility pole back to an existing macro cell tower in the area. So their job is to really, a couple of things. One is to improve service where areas currently lack coverage. Secondarily, the need for to enhance data transmission, because everybody's now using handheld devices and tablets, and the existing infrastructure can't support the increased demand to transfer data. So. And as you look into the future, this is only going to increase. So this is primarily to serve both of those purposes.
Would this help the areas that are blacked out or zones where you lose your cell phone coverage?
Yes, that's one of the reasons for doing this. Yes.
Do you have any idea approximately how many of these things you're going to be installing?
I don't know exactly until Verizon would do their engineering work. I'm estimating for this area roughly a half a dozen.
Is that for the whole township, the whole 115
square
miles? For the whole
township, yes.
Okay. So is this going to be applicable also to other communities? I know that some communities have terrible service. I think we're fortunate that some have less reliable service. Would they be candidates for this also? Or is it just fiber optic?
Well, this is for wireless transmission. for cellular. They're hardwired by fiber optic cable back to the tower, but this is that fiber optic cable is only going to serve these nodes, these antennas. Amen. It's not going to be brought to residences or businesses. But we're now reaching out to, this project's been in effect for about the last year and a half in northern and central New Jersey. We're now reaching out to all the municipalities in Cape May, Atlantic, Gloucester, and Ocean counties for now. And then probably early next year, we'll be reaching out to the remainder of the state. So.
Okay, my question really was, is this limited to areas that have fiber cable? In other words, if
no,
an area
not.
Doesn't,
then, no, it's
okay.
Not. No.
Thank you.
Well, I see here under federal law that we may not withhold approval, but we may impose reasonable conditions such as requiring insurance and repair to any damage caused, which have been included in the attached proposed resolution. I'm sure that's a matter of form, and you would have all the necessary insurance to cover any damage that may or may not be the result of your installations.
Yes, and the draft resolution that was included in the package has since been revised.
Mm-hmm.
We reviewed it with the Atlantic County GIF. We revised it a little bit to meet their insurance requirements. So, and I know I sent that back out to, I think I sent it to the clerk's office. So you should have that.
The new revised resolution?
I don't know. Can you look at the one?
But I have a copy here if you need it.
Yes, because I only remember getting the one resolution. I didn't get anything recently.
The difference is just in the amount of the
primarily it's
limits?
The insurance coverage, the dollar amount.
Oh yeah.
Okay, it's just the amount of insurance coverage.
Thanks.
And Mayor, just for the record, it was not the solicitor's office's opinion that you couldn't withhold permission. If you review the memo, it's limited discretion, but we don't view that you can't withhold under any circumstances.
Now you have the updated one, Rita.
Yeah, if I can just read it to you, because you
please.
Don't have it in front of you.
Please.
For letter D.
D?
Yes, where it says not less than 1 million.
Mm-hmm.
It's not less than 3 million combined single limit per occurrence and automobile insurance with combined single limits of, instead of 500,000, 2 million. Is that right? For bodily injury. That's not what this says.
Okay. Does anyone have any problem with that?
Got any connections with the Verizon people?
Verizon Wireless or Verizon Telephone?
Whoever owns the building on Main Street.
Is
the one they refused to fix up.
I can look into it for you.
I wish you would.
We would appreciate
We've
that.
We've talked to them several times and it's gotten nowhere.
Sounds like a, is it a retail Verizon wireless store or is it a?
No, it's
a switching station, I believe.
Oh, a switching station, okay.
Which
right here on Route 50?
Right in our, middle of our historic district.
And I think they are aware of it.
So the way I see this, and I know you have nothing to do with this, but for us to approve this, we're like being a good neighbor, yet they really haven't been.
Yeah.
So it's kind of tough.
I can look into it for you. Keep in mind, we represent Verizon Wireless, and Verizon Telephone is really a separate company.
Mm-hmm.
But I can.
I understand.
I can.
Just let me vent a little bit.
Sure.
I'll be okay.
We've all been trying, so. Okay.
So exactly what the issue is?
The issue is the way they keep their property.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact it's just a blah. And we have a historic district here. We wanted to get to them to try to do certain, make certain changes. We have a plan for Main Street. And trying to do it in a proper way,
mm-hmm.
just trying to get someone to cooperate, we don't get any results back.
It's visually unappealing.
Okay.
And we've offered to work with them. You know, they have a decent sized lawn in front where we talked to them about doing some type of a small park, you know, mm-hmm. some benches and stuff to kind of block the building. We're not interested. But
if you have any plans or any Anything you can share with me that I can...
Escape on that, right, John?
Yeah.
You give me your card, maybe we can talk later. How's
sure.
that?
Great.
That'd be great.
Okay.
Other questions?
I'll make a motion to move the resolution with the corrections with the insurance amounts, $3 million and $2 million, as read by our secretary.
I'll second.
Motion is second. Any other questions or comments? Rita?
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
And thank you for your willingness to carry that message. Okay?
Thank you very much. We appreciate that.
Thank you for your time.
Next item on the agenda is a resolution declaring B1758 Lot 7, the American Legion Hope Fire Company building, an area in need of redevelopment, non-condemnation, as recommended by the planning board. Mike? Phil? Come on up, Phil.
Thank you, Mayor. Also here tonight is Tiffany Cuviello, who is the planning consultant the Atlantic County Improvement Authority hired on our behalf to conduct the study. Taking a few steps back, it was mid-2015, committee authorized applications to the county's redevelopment initiative. We were funded for the redevelopment study of the American Legion building. You authorized the planning board undertake the determination of needs study earlier this year in May. Tiffany prepared the report and met a couple times with the planning board, once just to review the draft, and then finally for the actual public hearing on the determination of needs study. That was held on November 17th, and before I let Tiffany give you the short and sweet summary, the planning board did vote at that time to recommend you deem the American Legion / Hope Fire Company building a non-condemnation area in need of redevelopment. So with that, well, let Tiffany take over.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you? So what we have done for the ACIA and for the township is to look at this specific property to determine if it's in need of redevelopment under the state statute. This property has already been determined by the town as an area in need of rehabilitation from a former study. So the in need of redevelopment adds two additional powers. Those powers are allowing you to offer long-term tax abatements if so provided for the rehab of the property, as well as condemnation, which obviously is not part of this one because you have the non-condemnation area. The town already owns it. This incentive also, as an area in need of redevelopment, may help with other financing and preservation measures through New Jersey and the National Historic District in terms of providing additional opportunities to improve and restore the former American Legion property or Hope Fire Company building on Second Street. So there's everyone here, I'm sure, is familiar with where the property is. It's on Second Street. It had a former life as the American Legion building, had township offices in there at one point, and Hope Fire Company was one of the original inhabitants. Actually, I believe it at one point was also the Reliance Hose Company. There is a detailed historical review of the occupants and ownership of the property within the report. Under the standards, we felt and the planning board accepted that they met the statutory criteria under items A and D of the state redevelopment and housing law. And that is that the generality of the buildings are substandard, unsafe, unsanitary, dilapidated, or obsolescent, or possess any such characteristics, or are so lacking in light, air, or spaces to be conducive to unwholesome living or working conditions. And item D, which is the areas with buildings or improvements, which by reason of dilapidation, obsolescence, overcrowding, faulty arrangement or design, lack of ventilation, light and sanitary facilities, excessive land coverage, deleterious land use, an obsolete layout, or any combination of these or other factors are detrimental to the safety, health, morals, and welfare of the community. Very long,
you
but more or less.
Now.
Yeah. And you know how many times I've stood in front of the mirror trying to say obsolescence without messing it up, so I've gotten that down. the issue here is that the building has not been maintained. The last improvements that were done to it were over 16 years ago. The Department of Public Works has looked at it. They have sanctioned it off for lack of sanitary facilities inside the building because the plumbing isn't functioning. You have a roof that's falling apart that needs to be replaced. The conditions of the property are deteriorating, and the idea here is to take that condition and find a way to incentivize the improvement of it. This is step one, to find a way to provide additional incentives that the governing body and the planning board can work together with someone on. Step two is the redevelopment plan, and you'll see me back here in January or February with that aspect of it, which has already been reviewed by the planning board. I can go into more detail, but that should be sufficient for the record.
I do have a question, Ms. Sure. Cupielli, was that it?
Cupielli.
Cupielli?
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned, I think that this started in April, actually in the township, it started long before that, but certainly given the clear case of this building, could you give some insight as to why it takes so darn long? Now, I'm happy to say that you think you'll be back in January, February, but this is going on since April of last year. Why does it take so long?
Well, there's the study that had to be completed in coordination of the meetings and time with the planning board public hearings. Planning board was a public hearing. There had to be legal notices done. The redevelopment plan for the property is actually drafted and recommended by the planning board. You just can't adopt an ordinance. You can't start it in 1 year and adopt an ordinance the second year in 2017. So otherwise, we'd be doing that tonight and it would be completed. So the timing of that and coordinating meetings and schedules and public notice and getting all the background information and working with the Historic Commission took a little bit of time, but now it's complete.
I'm sure the Historic Commission is going to be very pleased that this is moving ahead. Our community is rich with a lot of such properties, and it's a shame sometimes to see them just go or have them go. The thought of having this preserved and brought back to a useful function is something they're looking forward to.
They were very excited in terms of hearing the prospects and opportunities.
Great. Thank you.
So you mentioned that step two is next, obviously. And then what comes after that?
What comes after that is that the town can either affirmatively market the property to a developer to rehab the property and enter into a developer's agreement. I know the next door neighbor is somewhat interested in rehabbing it. You may end up having conversations with her or some other entity in order to restore the property. After that redevelopment plan is adopted, you'll have that ability to negotiate with someone to work on that property. And the powers of redevelopment are really great because it basically throws out all your rules to a certain degree. It allows you to act as a business, not as a government, in negotiating on a property. And when you're dealing with something where you have such important aspects that you wish to restore, you don't just have to put it out to bid or for public sale, and any Joe Schmo can come in and pick it up and say, I'm just going to demolish it. You can say, if we sell this to you, you are restoring it in accordance with this plan. And that gives you that power, and that's important when you have an historic building, because most people just want to start over. And I don't think that's the intent of the township, otherwise you wouldn't have gone through this effort.
So there are no more reviews after this, then the ball is now in our court.
And, more or less, yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else have any other questions? What's your pleasure?
I'll make a motion to move the resolution for the American Legion Hope Fire
second.
Company building.
Motion is second. Any other questions or comments? Rita, let's get a roll call on that.
Okay. Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. C, resolution authorizing the submission of a HDSRF application for remedial action renewable energy grant for remediation of the Hamilton Township landfill block 994 lot 57.
Yeah. Yeah. Jeff Dye is here from LRS. He's the redeveloper of the landfill site.
Good evening, Mayor.
Good evening. How are you?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good to see you again. This is basically a resolution which is part of the application process. The municipality has to pass a resolution authorizing the submittal of the grant. We've talked about this grant for some time. This year I'd rather not answer questions about how long this project's taken, but anyway, that's a joke. I'm happy to answer those questions. This is simply the application to get in line for the grant process. Delay this year was really, we have got another project where this application's been submitted since 2010.
How long is this line?
3 months. But we've been waiting for, we switched to memorandum from Panasonic to now we're with Citizens Energy.
Okay.
As the solar developer. They have an agreement, the board of the Special Services School and the ACIT has approved their plan to provide them with the solar. So there's an off-taker for their power there. And we're doing the two projects, one on the landfill and one around the balance of the acreage. And we talked about that before, and have also talked about that with the Industrial Commission. And so now we have the user. It is going to be a renewable energy use, so we can use this particular grant application, which is what we're going to apply for. There's a number of other items besides that. You just have a general application and a budget summary. That budget detail will be provided with the application along with a bunch of other information, redevelopment agreement, copy of the deed, and other items that will go with the application. We'll get that together for signature should the committee approve this resolution to proceed.
I ask you this every time.
Yes, sir.
You still feel confident that this is going to happen?
Oh, yes, much, much confident, more confident now, particularly with Citizens on board. They have done half a dozen or so projects on landfills in Massachusetts, and we got involved with them beginning part of this year. This is the third such project that we're engaged in. We actually just got selected last week for a landfill down in a commercial township, not too far by. So, and the other project is over on the east coast of the state here in National Park. That's the one that's been in for a long time. And one of the challenges with this renewable energy grant is the department doesn't quite know how to, if they were to issue the grant funds for reimbursement and we remediate the landfill, what's their assurance that it actually is going to be a renewable energy facility? Because all the remediation work done will be finished before you construct the facility. So that chicken and egg scenario, they've been trying to deal with, but they being the DEP and the EDA. And we now have a scenario where we think we can satisfy that. We'll be providing a 25% of the match funds for the grant, and we may also finance the entire project as part of this chicken and egg scenario, and then the grant would be reimbursed.
Assuming you get the grant, everything goes, is that?
The grant, we may be able to do it without the grant, but it'll be tough. Yeah.
Okay.
We're pursuing some plans B and C, but.
Can I ask what percentage of the school's electrical energy requirements you are going to meet, and what does that translate to in terms of savings, and even carbon savings, if you happen to know?
I don't have those numbers. I can give you some estimates for myself. Our solar,
yeah, just estimates.
Yeah, our solar partner from Citizens, Kevin, he's been down and met a couple times with Phil, has those figures. The savings is pretty significant. They offer two options. One is a fixed rate over the period of time, which is 20 years with two renewals, so that the rate remains fixed. It has to be by statute at least a 10% savings. I think they're looking at almost a 20% savings roughly here. I'm not exactly sure. The other is a percentage below market. So the Citizens offers two options to the user. We're actually doing two projects here, just to be clear. One on the landfill prop, well, depending on which, the sequencing of which one. One is going to be for the schools. The other is going to go into the grid. Which would just be a grid supply project. To answer your question, what percentage, they would be at about 60 to 70% of their total load would be renewable.
Very good.
They have a rooftop system in now, and that's only servicing about 10%. So this picks up that other percentage of about 50 to 60 more percentages.
Obviously, there's a lot of carbon savings associated with
that.
Yes,
very much so. That I don't have any idea exactly what that is, but I can get that information for you. And we expect that hopefully this grant approval, the interconnection studies from both PJM and from Atlantic City Electric are due back end of the first quarter. And we're going to be submitting our landfill closure plans, remedial action plans to the department. So sometime end of the first quarter, into the second quarter, we look to have a lot of these approvals coming in place, and then we can set our schedule and actually talk about some construction activities.
You know, it's been a long journey.
It sure has.
What's your pleasure?
Can I ask a general question? And maybe you don't have the answer to this, but I know the solar energy companies are very active with residential homes, but it seems with commercial facilities, they seem to be much more reticent, and I'm not sure why.
Much more reticent,
much less likely to get involved. And I don't know what the reason for that is.
The solar market, obviously, you know, it crashed a few years back, and now things are better. I don't know the exact reason for why it would be slower on the commercial side. We're working with citizens because they're just come down to New Jersey being very aggressive. They're looking at brownfields and landfill sites. There are also a number of rooftop sites on larger commercial facilities where it makes sense. Some of the legislative and regulatory changes that occurred because of the crash is they're really prohibiting you from greenfields or non-contaminated property. So some commercial facilities that might have some acreage, they may have a little bit of an issue with installation. I'm not sure if that's a factor at all. But I think that the market is healthy, and rather than when the SRECs were 600, everybody was doing it. And it kind of got a little bit out of control. Seems like more responsible folks are moving forward. We do have a concern, just as a kind of a public announcement, that some of the companies are really pushing on the residential side, and that may be actually kind of an issue. You know, a lot of these rooftops weren't actually designed to hold that load, the weight. And you know, what do you do when you have a residential house and you want to sell it in 10 years, but you have this asset on top? So it's a little bit of a challenge in the residential market, even though there are a lot of companies pushing to get the lease and install it. It's a good thing if you're going to stay in a home for a long time.
It's a pleasure.
I'll make a motion to move the resolution authorizing submission of the application for the Remedial Action and Renewable Energy Grant for the HDSRF.
I'll second.
A motion is second. Any other questions or comments? Rita?
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silver?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank
you. Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and Happy New Year.
Great holiday. Next item on the agenda is the to re-advertise for some RFQs for certain professionals. Michael?
Yes, sir, Mayor. I have a list. The Township Architect, Township Auditor, Bond Counsel, Certified General Appraiser, Township Engineer, and Traffic Engineer.
I'll make a motion to resubmit for RFQs.
Hold on a second, Mike. John, I think Art brought up a good point. Can we add in good.
I think we need to put the prosecutor back out again.
Yeah, the only difference that we need to talk about is these are due back January 11th. I think you'd want the prosecutor due back December 28th.
All right, so let's go with this, John, first, and then we will separate then come back on a prosecutor, okay? Go ahead, John.
Okay. I'll make a motion to resubmit for the RFQs for the positions just read by our administrator.
I'll second it.
Second, I'm sorry.
No, so go ahead. Second. Any questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
No, Art brought up a good one. Also, now go ahead, Mike, on the prosecutor.
If you want to have it returned on December 28th, that's a Wednesday. That's the that's our meeting. Or
as long as we have it back in time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's a good date.
If I remember correctly, we had a decent response to that already, mm-hmm. But I wanted it out again because I want everyone to understand that it's now an open seat.
Right.
And I think there may be some people out there that they may want to step up where they wouldn't have before.
Right.
Yep. Good point.
So I'll make a motion that we put the application out for prosecutor.
Second.
To be back on the 28th?
28th.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Rita?
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carried.
Thank you. 4, public hearing, adoption of ordinance. An ordinance 1838-2016, an ordinance authorizing the sale of lots 12, 18, and 19 in block 362, as shown on the tax map in the Township of Hamilton, and granting to the owner or owners of said real property contiguous to the same the right of prior refusal to purchase said land in the Township of Hamilton, County of Atlantic, State of New Jersey. This is a public hearing. Anyone in the public wish to speak?
Move to, oh, sorry.
Hey, Roger, where's block 362 at?
Pardon?
Where's block 362 at?
Shreveport and Arlington Avenue. It's Mitzvah Village.
Mitzvah?
Mm-hmm. You okay? Okay. It's a public hearing. Anyone else in the public wish to speak?
Move to close the public hearing.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion opposed. What's your pleasure?
Make a motion to adopt the ordinance.
Second.
A motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and adopted.
Thank you. Number 5, award bids and contracts. A, authorize a 2-year extension of award of bid 2014-19 pump maintenance and testing for the Township of Hamilton's fire apparatus to Fire Apparatus Repair, Inc., Hamilton, New Jersey, in accordance with the proposal attached for the term January 1, 2017 through December 31st, 2017.
Mr. Mayor, this is our second 1-year extension. So it could be extended one more after this.
Right. So. Motion to award.
I'll second.
Motion to second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes, thank you.
All yes and carry.
B, award a contract to Engineer and Design Associates for architectural and engineering services for the new public bathroom building in Underhill Park in the amount not to exceed the lump sum of $18,000.
I'll make a motion to award the contract. And also, I just want to mention that this is good news and we're so happy to see this moving forward, Steve.
Thank you.
I did talk.
And the second. People that use the field are even happier.
Motion is second. Any questions or comments?
If I could, Mayor, I just wanted to mention I did talk with Steve and this will be ready in the winter to bid, so that we can break ground early spring.
Good.
Great.
Thank you, Steve.
Rita?
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
Well, yes, and thank you.
Consent agenda. Remember, we removed B and F, and I want to pull out H and K for separate vote.
Well, then I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda items A, C through E, G, I and J, and L and H.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Now H. H is a resolution accepting the contiguous owner land sale bid of John Lugo for lot 15, block 606, 4.6 acres on Estella Avenue for a purchase price of $4,700.
I'll make a motion to accept.
I'll second.
I have a motion as second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Thank you. Let me just get that a second here. K has approved the budget transfers as recommended by the Chief Financial Officer. You have a list of them there in front of you. You have a list in front of you for the tax collector, engineering service costs, police and traffic control, and street lighting.
Make a motion to make the proper adjustments.
Second.
The motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes, thank you.
All yes and carry.
Okay, personnel.
Mayor, I'm sorry, we had a miscommunication.
Huh?
We had a miscommunication. There does need to be a vote on B&F.
B&F, yes.
Oh, there has to be, huh?
They were pulled just because there needs to be an addition to both of them.
Evan, can you tell me what you want added to the resolution?
Sure. In addition to what's already stated, it should provide authorization to the solicitor.
Yeah. Deny the release of Liberty Mutual Insurance Company in the amount of $528,530.80, posted as a two-year maintenance guarantee for the 2012 road program Phase 2 IREC paving due to the incomplete punch list as recommended by Robert Smith in his correspondence dating 8/25/2016.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Okay. F, deny the release of Hudson Insurance Company in the amount of $398,608.23, posted as a two-year maintenance guarantee for Town Hall Auxiliary Parking Lot due to incomplete punch list items as recommended by Robert Smith and his correspondence dated 10/7/16 and 11/16/16.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Thank you. Item 7, personnel. Resolution appointing Dorothy Gallagher as Chief Financial Officer for a four-year term effective January 1, 2017 through December 31st, 2020.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Congratulations, Dorothy.
Yes. Congratulations.
The resolution appointing Annette Passe as violations clerk effective 1/4/17 at $30,075.31 annually as per collective bargaining agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Thank you. C, resolution appointing Lisa Marcolongo as the Historic Preservation Commission Secretary effective 1/1/17 at $2,640 annually as per recommendation by the Historic Preservation Commission.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
D, accept the resignation of James Rhodes from the Industrial Commission five-year term ending 12/31/2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
E, resolution promoting Michael Hughes to electric subcode official inspector at an annual salary of $55,000 effective 12/20/16.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
F, resolution appointing Frank Primavera as property maintenance enforcement officer at an annual salary of $5,000 effective 12/20/16.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Any questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
G, resolution appointing Stephen Kramer as full-time temporary labor at $15.30 per hour for a period not to exceed 11 months effective 12/21/2016.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second.
I have a question.
Sure.
What exactly is a full-time temporary labor?
He'll work 40 hours a week, but only for up to 11 months.
Oh, okay.
He doesn't get any benefits.
Okay.
And this is actually replacing an
injury. So the full-time is that he works a full week, but not a full year?
Yes.
Okay.
You got that whole vote, right, Reed?
We didn't vote on that. You have a motion and a second, and then we stopped.
Yeah. Can we have a roll call?
Sure. Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
H, resolution appointing Sheila Garrison as clerk three effective 12/21/16 at $31,356.61 annually as per collective bargaining agreement.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Schenker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Thank you. Okay, eight, approval minutes of December 5th, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
That was under, motion is second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion opposed. Motion carried. Hold a second. We did.
Okay, I got you. All right, gotcha.
Okay. B, payroll and bills totaling the bill list of $1,978,248.71.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comments? Rita.
Mr. Gishard?
Yes.
Mr. Kurtz?
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Schenker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Reports, Mr. Administrator.
Nothing to add to the written report. Happy to answer questions.
Mr. Solicitor.
Nothing to add.
Thank you. Mr. Engineer.
Yeah, Mayor and Committee, I have a report dated December 19th, and the first item is Buffalo Pike Associates Volunteer Way. On December 9th, they completed the base coat and the final paving. I've been out there after a rainfall. It's draining well. Structurally, the road is in excellent condition. What remains is line striping and signs. It occurred to me a number of weeks ago when I saw the first sign that went up on the Wrangleboro Road jug handle, you know, that the word shopping center is on that sign. So I reviewed the signs with the DOT, and the reason I started to do that is because when Volunteer Connector Road was originally approved, it was approved the same time the Buffalo Pike Shopping Center was approved. So it was intended that both projects would sort of go together. Today we have just the connector road. So, Mayor, what I've done is I've asked Kevin Dixon, our traffic consultant, to sort of assist me with looking at the signage and the line striping and the barriers, because we don't want anybody on the connector road distracted with an entrance to the shopping center, because if you're on the connector road today, they've paved the section that just starts to go into the Buffalo Pike Associates Shopping Center. So what I've done, Mayor, is I've asked Kevin Dixon to give me some assistance in making sure the road signs that are about to go in are correct, you know, as just this one phase is completed, the line striping's perfect, and that the barriers traveling on the connector road from the jug handle or traveling east on Volunteer Way, that there's a barrier there that nobody could mistakenly come in into the connector road. So the project structurally is turning out very well. We just have a few pieces of this to complete. DOT gave me another schedule. They keep giving me schedules because they never seem to match the schedule that they gave me previously. The week of January 24th is when they're telling me all work will be done, the shoulder work, the signal work. So that's the latest, Mayor. On a positive note with the project, Buffalo Pike Associates, Benderson Corporation called me about a week ago a number of times. They want to make sure that all of the plans that came through the planning board are completed, ready to be signed off. And of course I ask, who's coming in and how soon are you going to start? I don't get an answer to that, but they said they want to be ready in the spring in case they're ready to start. And they said there's been a lot more interest with the clearing that's occurred out there.
And they won't give you...
The sidewalk's been along the highway line up there too.
The sidewalks is, yes.
Yes.
And they won't give you any anchor store information.
I can't get anything out of them.
How about that? But once the area that's barricaded that enters the, it'll be a barricade that enters into the shopping area off of Volunteer Way, that is a complete connection now through?
It just sort of stubs into the shopping center and stops.
Oh, I got you. Eventually, but that'll be shut off so nobody will turn in there.
It'll be shut off. Yeah. Yes, there'll be some type of barrier there. And again, I've asked Kevin Dixon. I've known him over 30 years. He's excellent.
Right.
That's his specialty, but he's just a good civil engineer, and I just want him looking over my shoulder, because ultimately the township engineer is the one that gives permission to say to DOT, okay, the road can open up.
It can open up.
The road isn't open yet, though, right?
It is not open yet.
Good. Good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
I just have a few other items. Holy Cross Cemetery, they continue construction. Woods Landing, we had one more house occupancy. Auto Zone, a week and a half ago, the base coat and the final paving was completed, with the exception of the entranceway that comes off of McKee Avenue, because they don't want to destroy the asphalt, so they're leaving the asphalt to last on that while they construct the building. Michael Zindorf on Harding Highway, you've probably have seen, he's cleared the 4 acres for his expansion. Mercy Medical was a punch list that I signed off on last week. South Jersey Gas had three new road openings, and a week ago we had a workshop meeting for Bogdan Boulevard was the name of the corporation, Intex. This is across from Wheaton's on Old Harding Highway, the 11-acre parcel. They're planning on coming in, and it's a company that makes, out of PVC, they make specialty architectural features. Like they told us at the work session, like Harvard University has a lot of architectural features on their buildings that need to be replaced that were, you know, from 100 years ago out of wood. This company, very, very sophisticated, they remake any architectural features out of PVC. They're going to employ 65 employees. They're relocating from the across the street from the Millville Airport. So they think they found a home, and we're pretty excited about them coming in.
That's great. We need that.
Yeah. You know, I just visited Princeton. I wonder if they work there too, because they've got some, you know, some old style, and they've got new buildings, and they got to try to mix them in. It's an interesting place architecturally.
Yes. That it, sir?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Township committee members. Bobby?
Yes. Today being the last meeting I have with you guys, I want to say thank you to everyone who made the transition for me into public office seamless. I've met some great people inside this township, and I have hope for our direction. Mike, thanks. Rita, Chief Tapia, thank you for everything you've done for the kids, and you know, whenever we needed you, you've been right there. And thank you so much for being so informational. What can I say about you, man? You've done so much, man. Thank you so much, and all the support that you guys gave me to make this, you know, like I said, a really great experience. I also would like to, you know, let everybody know that this doesn't mean anything as far as elections and stuff like that are concerned. A lot of things are said and done. I spoke with Judy some time ago, and she mentioned something called silly season. I understand it now. I get it. Thanks for the heads up. But I should have listened. Great job to you all, and thank you so much.
Thank you.
I appreciate you. But I don't agree with that term, silly season. You still have to have a brain in that head on your shoulders, and you've got to understand what common decency is.
I understand.
Okay, and that was missed. Rodney?
Just a couple of things. I attended a... what shall I call it? A ceremony at St. John's Church in MISPA, recognizing several sheriff people from the sheriff department for their participation in police chaplains, and also for other services they provided to the community. The community was really appreciative of what they've done. It was a very nice ceremony. And I was impressed with the police chaplains. That's an organization that was established by an Atlantic County chaplain, police officer. And essentially what it does is the police work with chaplains to address what kind of traumatic situations or situations where there's, you know, injuries or deaths or whatever involved. And certainly the chaplains is probably no better resource for working with the police on some of these things. They understand people, they have a lot of trust, they can be comforting, and it has worked very well. I think I mentioned once today, I attended a meeting out in Atlantic City organized by chaplains involving police commissioners from several towns around the area and citizens, and it included the mothers and relatives of people who had been shot by policemen. policemen who were in the units of the commissioners who were there. But it was held, the meeting was held very well, and it was held very well because of the skills, I think, of the people that conducted the meeting. So the police chaplains organization is, I think, a very beneficial one. It started here in Atlantic County. It's now expanded to other parts of New Jersey. And in fact, I believe all the townships here, or most of the townships here, are members of it. It's also extended to Pennsylvania, and it is going to go nationwide. So that's something that, that started here, and it's a good, good organization.
Looks like that's a grocery list. You sure you got that?
Yeah. I just wanted to mention, I see Domino's. Unfortunately, I missed. I think they had some kind of opening today.
Yeah, like a soft opening.
Soft opening, yeah, that was the term. And I guess they'll be having the grand opening sometime soon. But it's great to see see that happen. I'm looking forward to the pizza. I also attended a Fleet Reserve Association annual luncheon here. And the Fleet Reserve Association consists of military organizations associated with the sea, the Coast Guard, the Marines, the Navy, and they have moved to bases now in Hamilton Township, and that's great. As part of that organization, we have several Hamilton Township residents. Al Davenport, for example, is going to be, is becoming a regional vice president. So we'll have four or five states, and that's great. And they've received several national awards for their increase in membership, and they've given out thousands of dollars in scholarships to local schools, Stockton and others. So it was a very nice affair with great people. They're going to be putting some of their materials in the VFW building, and we welcome them and look forward to working them, and it's a great addition to the town. So I just thought I'd mention that. And I want to wish everybody a happy holiday. I hope we'll have a chance to meet with family and have a great holiday season.
Mark?
Yeah, I just want to say, Bobby, it's we should be thanking you. You've done a great job, even though it's been a short time you've been here. I've gotten to know Bobby very well over the last couple years. He's a class act, and you know, when you get into a conversation about silly season, at no time were you ever silly. So I appreciate your professionalism. I appreciate the way you handle yourself. And also, I don't know that a lot of people may not know this, but Bobby does a tremendous amount of things for the youth of this township. Helps out with kids that may be on the wrong direction, and helps them find the right direction. And that takes a special person to spend that kind of time away from your family, away from your own children, to help others. And I gotta tell you, it's been, you've made me a better person for knowing you, so I appreciate it. Thank you. And I know you'll still be around, so.
Thank you.
You're not going away, right?
Nope.
You're not moving?
You're right.
All right, great. And I'd also like to wish everyone a happy holiday, no matter what religion or what holiday you celebrate. To be with your family at this time of the year is special. I know all my wife and I suffer from the empty house syndrome, and now it's going to be full in the next couple days. But it's only going to be full for a couple days, and it'll be empty again. So, you know, enjoy it while you can. If you can, make sure that there's anybody you know that doesn't have family, make sure you open your door and let them in. We try to do that every year, and makes our holidays a little bit better. So happy holidays, everybody. Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Art. John?
I have a comment on a couple things. Rodney touched on Domino's. I just wanted to say about the impact that actually has on our downtown. I was in there when they first opened, and there aren't many places, I guess, other than a Wawa. When you turn the key, there's a line at the door, and that's what happened there. There was a line out the door and a few onto the street waiting to get in, and the part that interested me was that I went there to order lunch, and I didn't recognize one of the people that were waiting, which tells you that they're not from downtown. They came from all parts of the township to do with an excellent advertisement brochure that they sent out to our entire zip code. So what it did is it pulled new people into our town, and it was amazing to see that many folks that were don't normally come into this part of town there getting something, and I think that's going to continue. So I think it's going to be finally a success on that corner. We're looking forward to it, and I'm sure it'll bring some needed traffic into the downtown with new people that don't necessarily come into our historic district. I just wanted to mention, while the chief's sitting here too, there is an issue where a 18-wheeler pulled up on Route 40 to make deliveries to them at 6 o'clock this morning, and they just stopped on Route 40, and they didn't put cones out, nothing, and they took an hour and a half to unload, and there was some close calls there. But it just seems to me, I don't know how that slipped by. Was usually we discussed that at a planning board level, but it didn't go there. So, you know, about what kind of trucks they have that are bringing their deliveries, maybe they could have a smaller truck, because that really did create a safety issue there this morning. Also, I'd just like to mention, I did attend a joint insurance fund dinner over at in Vineland. And we got a substantial dividend coming back to our township from following the safe practices in all the departments and keeping people safe and following the procedures and policies that need to happen was why we got that dividend. And I thought that was a good thing. The meeting was very interesting. And I'd just like to mention, similar to everyone else, about the holidays. This is our last meeting, and I have a sign in my office that says, "Never get so busy making a living that you forget to make a life. Please enjoy your friends, your family, and your faith, and have a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays." Thank you.
Nice comments. You always have an add-on.
Well, that's because I always forget. First of all, I attended that Jeff meeting also, and it was good, but I did want to thank Bobby myself for his involvement. As you mentioned, it's a class act, and I recall, well, first of all, I was working with the gentleman before Bobby with the Knights, and what a fantastic job that person did, and what a great job Bobby's doing. And I remember the presentation he gave
here
with people from Washington and all around.
45 minutes of our meeting time.
That's right, but it was an excellent presentation, and it was certainly an example of the kind of stuff that he's doing, and that was much appreciated. And the program, I guess, went pretty well.
Very well. Thank
yes,
you.
Yeah, that's good. That's a summer program involving youth in the area, and that went very well. And so that's appreciated. I also recall a football game up in North Jersey,
yes,
where the Knights, as well as many of the MLAA folks, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, you paid for a lot of that, or at least for
well,
some
we,
of it?
I paid for a lot, but we had some other donors, Judy and her husband,
all
were
right,
kind enough to
yes,
donate, and so was Bob.
Well, that was a big success. The kids really, really enjoyed it, and that was much appreciated. So, thank you. And I'm sorry I didn't mention it before.
All right. Do you want to check any other papers before I...
Well, yeah, actually, I could. That's all right.
Just to repeat, our reorg is January the 3rd, 2017. It's a Tuesday and at 6 p.m. I guess this time of the year, when everybody looks around, we take for granted many things. And I think I'd be remiss if I didn't call to your attention the work of our first responders, both our policemen and women, our volunteer firemen and women, our first aiders, and the work that they do. One only has to understand every time they get a call, they don't know what to expect, and they could be confronted by anything. So I salute each and every one of them, and I know the job is not an easy one. And you know, my youngest son happens to be a police officer, and I remember him telling me, so the first time he went out and he had to use the AED, and he wasn't successful, and he felt very bad about it. And about 5 weeks ago, he and another officer in town had saved a life, and I said to him, I said, you know, going through life with that on your conscience that you saved somebody's life is worth any award that they could give you. So I always salute the first responders. And Bobby, you're a great running mate. You're a great addition to the committee. I'm gonna miss you. I think you should hang around. there's a lot for you to do in our community, and hopefully you'll continue in that direction. And I'd like to thank all the employees in this township for the work they do. The more people I talk to, the more situations we get involved in, you come to find out that a lot of people look at our community. Despite all the criticism that comes from the floor at times, we have a great community here, we have a great town hall, and everything we do is in the right direction, and it's the result of all our people doing a great job, so I thank you. And with that, I'll open it up to the public, and I'll wish each and every one of you, and I'll say it, a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, and season's greetings to those who don't follow those words. Anyone in the public wish to speak? Please, Jim.
Jeez. Yeah, I want to wish everyone a Happy Christmas and a very Merry New Year.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Bob, you're going to be missed.
Thank you.
But at the same time, I hope you will still be here every 2 weeks like I am.
All right. Okay.
There you go. That's a challenge.
That's a challenge.
You're here to throw it down.
And I want to
gauntlet.
Wish Dot.
That's it, Jim.
their appointments. They'll do very well in their new endeavors.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Jim.
That is it.
Happy holidays to you.
You too.
Anyone else in the public?
Motion to close public portion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Excuse me. Number 11. Adjourn to executive session.
Be it resolved by the Township Committee of the Township of Hamilton that this meeting be adjourned to an executive session to discuss the following matters, which are exempt from public discussion pursuant to the New Jersey Open Public Meetings Law. 1, Santor Gravel Pit Bond Claim Against Lincoln General Insurance Company, attorney-client privilege and pending litigation. And 2, discussion of potential litigation regarding 142 Knightsbridge Way for potential litigation. Be it further resolved that the governing body will reconvene in public session and confirm the results of the executive session if there is a majority consensus for action to be taken on the matter tonight.
Thank you. Make a motion.
Make a motion to adjourn.
A second.
To executive session.
To executive session.
All in favor?
Yes. Aye.
We're going to hold it right in this room, so.
Yep.
We're back in regular session?
Yep.
Okay, we're back in regular session. And
okay, I'd like to make the motion in the matter of the Santor gravel pit that we authorize our solicitor to file an appeal and negotiate with the liquidator for a resolution.
Good.
Second.
Motion is second. Questions or comment? Rita?
Mr. Gishard?
Yes, I just want one question. File an appeal. Is it necessary to say what the appeal is, or is that sufficient? Just say file an appeal. Is that enough?
You could add to the liquidator's appeal to the liquidator's determination if you want to be full about it, and that works.
Okay. Just.
I'll amend my motion to add that.
And I vote yes.
Oh, she's got to call you.
Mr. Kurtz?
Oh, I thought you did.
Yes.
Mr. Laws?
Yes.
Mr. Shanker?
Yes.
And Mayor Silva?
Yes.
All yes and carry.
Okay. We have a motion.
Motion to close.
Adjourn.
To adjourn.
Second.
The public meeting.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Meeting.
Thanks for coming.